Okay, so this is a collaboration between my group at School of Mines and Los Alamos and the Berkeley Lab, and some of the authors are here. So actually, this is a project where we are looking at a number of mechanisms of trapping, capillary trapping and dissolution trapping, and the ultimate goal is actually for us to help to improve models. So I don't have to use this slide, spend a lot of time on this slide. I think we know that the numerical models are going to play an important role in the site selection and determine storage potential and injection design and permanence assessment. But the validation within the quotation marks actually is sort of difficult to do in the field because the data is not easily available in the field. So the idea behind this presentation, again focusing on experimentation, is to develop a novel laboratory techniques where we can do this testing in a very large systems rather than pressure controls in small columns to understand some of the issues related to heterogeneity. So I'm going to take this example from the Yutsira formation and Sleipner, and then as you see, some of you are familiar with this particular site. You could see that when you have the injection and when you look at the final distribution as you using geophysical techniques, you could see that there's accumulation beneath this cap rock. This is these layers, and then there's a vertical migration in the early stages, and then it started accumulating, and then most of the time they obtain this qualitatively how much is stuck in the soil. So actually we had done some experiment in the past applied to non-aqueous phase liquids, and this is a sort of similar experiment where we are injecting fluid in a formation with this sort of a cap rock here, and this is a completely homogeneous system. And if I look at the same experiment, same amount of fluid injection in a sort of random field with this capillary barrier effect, you see the same features you see here. So some of the issues we are of interest to here is actually can be seen in this experiment. So a lot of the motivation for our work come from the need to do these sub experiments under control conditions so we can understand the conceptual issues and somehow generate good data to validate model. The second issue we are talking about, the previous speaker talked about, is that so in the conventional dissolution modeling, actually dissolution conceptualization, this is the picture you normally see. So you see the convective fingers go down due to this density driven effects. And then I think, so this is the traditional convective thing. What we are trying to look at is that actually we are hypothesizing that if you have a formation with this heterogeneous layers with the low permeabilities, and then where the diffusion is going to play a role, and then you may not see this propagation as you see in this case. And the third issue we have interest to us is that if once this dissolved fluid goes into the formation inside, it's going to diffuse in, and then some of the things are going to return back. So we are going to investigate that. So again, I mentioned this earlier. Okay, the third issue we are interested in is the whole issue of leakage, and in this case, we are looking at what's happening in the shallow subsurface. So we have a gas leaking here, and then the gas leaks here. The thinking is that when the gas leaks here, some of them can escape through the land atmospheric boundary layer. But what we are trying to understand is what is the effect of heterogeneity in the gas evolution process as well as the accumulation. So what we hypothesize is that the formation itself has an accumulation capacity which is controlled by this trapping of the gas at the dissolution. So this is the approach we have been using, and I'm going to spend a lot of time. The idea here is that you move from smaller scale to field scale, and we follow both the numerical models and the experiments. And we define a scale called the intermediate scale. This is a scale in between the field and the lab system. So if you look at the problem, so you see that there are a lot of work done in this core scale. This is some of the work done by Ronnie Penny and then at Stanford, and this is another example of the post-scale processes. And this is what is happening in the field. So the intermediate scale is a scale between this and this, where we try to understand these processes through this control experiment. So I'm going to talk about some of this experiment we are doing, looking at the three problems we talked about here. So here, normally we define the intermediate scale to be somewhere around the meter scale, in this case of 2.4 meters is the one we use in our experiment. So what are the challenges in doing this type of experiments in the large tanks is that you cannot use real CO₂. So this is the idea people have explored in the past. So what we do is we actually use this analog fluids, and we mix this analog fluids to get some of the properties we like to mimic in the field. So in this particular case, we are looking at the viscosity and density ratio. So if you look at the correct mixture of glycerol and water, 80% glycerol, so we can actually adjust this, and you can get this range of viscosity ratios and the density. There are other bond numbers and this are involved in other analysis, which I'm not going to talk about. So I'm going to take this example, and this is one of the experiments and we did, and this is actually after injection 91 hours and without trusting the movies. I'm going to actually go through a sequence of slides in a minute. So we also have the capability, which obviously you don't have in the field, to measure this saturation distribution quite accurately using an X-ray attenuation system. So what you see as contours are exact measurements of the saturation. So with this type of data, we can actually look at the processes more carefully and put this into the models. So this is, I'm going to go through this slides, hope this mouse works. So what you see here, the injection, what you see here, there are two injection times. We are looking at injection here in this period, another injection here. And then what we are going to do is we are going to follow this plume, and we are going to just to quantify the location of the plume, we are going to take the first moment, and we can take the second moment and look at the spread. But the first moment will tell you where the center of gravity of the plume is, the center of mass of the plume is. So from that, we can sort of track the general behavior of the plume. So I'm going to go through this fast, and you see here that initially at time zero, when you start injecting, you see that, so again, this is the right of the tank, and this is the left of the tank. When you move around here, you are moving this way along the tank. So now you can see, as you see here, I wanted to follow this. Now the buoyancy is taking over, and you see nothing is moving. The X moment remained the same here. And as you see, the buoyancy is still moving the thing up here. As soon as I come here, now it's going to hit the cap rock, and now the lateral flow will start pushing in this way. You'll notice this thing here. Now we are going to the redistribution phase, and then now the plume is redistributing, and as soon as we come here, now we have a second injection, which is going to happen here. So now you see a second injection. Again, the plume start moving, the center of mass start moving. It follows the same path. Obviously, it's going to not follow exact the path, but it's going to follow that same pathway, and then it keeps going, and I'll go this fast. And then, so the idea behind this type of experiments is that we can actually compare this experiment with a completely homogeneous, a heterogeneous. So now in this particular case, this is, without getting into detail, this is a layered system we filled. And if you follow the same procedure, you can see that we are controlling the head here. And then there are 5-6 sands we use to pack the tank. It's a layered system. And you see that, again, I like you to follow these bullets here, and I like you to follow this graph here. Now the plume started moving, and again you'll see that these are phenomena we have seen in the other application in non-aqueous liquids. So this capillary barrier effect started building up, and then there are some fingering going on through the system, and it started, the plume started migrating. So then you can follow the same center of mass here, and then you could see the center of mass develops, and now this is quite different from the way the homogeneous system behaves. So you could see that the center of mass keeps going down, and then it started moving this preferentially through these channels, and then we are going to go to the second injection, and the second injection is going to spread, and again you see it started appearing here. So these are all controlled by this capillary barrier effects we saw earlier. So the question is, again, I'm not going to get into the details, that we are actually seeing whether the models can capture these processes, and I think it is most of the models we have tested is not at this scale, at this type of accuracy, they are not able to capture some of these things well. So. Okay, the next one I'm going to look at is the convective mixing problem. So in the convective mixing problem, again, this is the picture. You see these are three sands. Again, we are using analog fluids to mimic what's going on in the convective mixing with the brine and CO2, dissolved CO2. So it's a completely homogeneous, and you can see that the permeability of the sand determines how the fingers are going to behave. Now let's look at this issue we talked about in relation to layering. So you can see that the plume starts here. Now suddenly get disrupted by this very fine layer, and again this had to do the Rayleigh number. Suddenly diffusion takes over, and fingering start happen here. So then we look at if you look at a formation where there's a connected pathways. Now in addition to the convective mixing, is controlled by these preferential pathways which are happening through these connected pathways. So then what we did was. There's a poster downstairs this morning, but the idea here is that we are going to do a simulation now looking at, in this particular case, we are looking at, again, the first moment will tell you how fast this plume is moving down, and then in this case, we are looking at the blue lines are the homogeneous, and this is a heterogeneous system. So you can see this is the time, and this is the first moment where the center of mass is. So as you see that if I take the same location of the center of mass, so you can see that the center of mass in the case of the layer system is always going to lag. It is seven. This is got in 7 hours and it got 18 hours. And you can do the same thing with this system. We have the preferential channels. You could see the same thing, and you can see that the homogeneous system and the heterogeneous system are going to behave differently. And this is about three days, and this is about 7 days. So some of these experiments take this long for us to get out these type of numbers. Okay, now what I like to do is to do some simulations, and in this case we took a sort of synthetic test system here. We have this is a completely homogeneous, and then you could see how the fingers produce the convective mixing. Now what we did was we took this simulation. We have put layers of shale in this system, and then we look at in this. We have done many simulations, but we are looking at the issue of the permeability of the shale layer, and these are like a fold of difference in magnitude. You see that when the shale layer, there are four orders here, you could see there's this particular dissolution is completely stopped here. Now it's going to go finger through this. And then, again, this is in the post today, so you could see that I'm plotting the total mass, which is retained on the top of the formation as a function of... Oh, man. Can I go back? Okay. Cannot go back. Yeah. One more. Okay. One, no, front. Yeah. Front. Next one. Okay, so now you can see that the homogeneous formation, the fingers all went down, but when you look at the heterogeneous formation, it is somehow held up in the formation because of the phenomena I described earlier, because of this shale basically holding the trapping the thing along the plume. So then the third issue we investigate has to do with the bubble formation. Again, there are a number of papers where we actually look at the issue of bubble evolution in columns and some 2D tanks. Again, some of the issues I talked about earlier with the bubble formation, bubble accumulation, and then we investigated that. So to look at that problem, we in this particular case, you see that the maximum gas saturation as a function of, we define oversaturation pressure in one of the papers in WRR. So you can immediately see that when you have this type of formation here, there will be trapping underneath the formation. So this is obvious of course, but I think we were able to relate that to some theoretical model to predict how this thing happens. So we are in the process of developing a new model. We are actually running a 2D experiment with a lot of sensors to understand this accumulation capacity. So I think this is just a flavor of what we do. And again, these are some conclusions. And that's sort of take my time.
Okay, yeah. Great. Yeah. Thank you. Do we have some questions for Tisa?
I thought I took all my time. Yeah. Yeah.
When you look at the ultra formation, when it's a 3D structure, in fact, and you have collision with the IPML materials, so it does not involve this kind of phenomenon.
So I want to make sure that we were using the formation as a test system. I think we are not making the argument that's a real system. So we are primarily focusing on the... We are using it like a geological model which has these features which are continuous this way. This is a 2D simulation. The point we are trying to make in that particular simulation is not to really simulate a real system, but we are making the argument that this layering has the capacity to attenuate the dissolution trapping. Yeah, so you are correct. In a fully 3D system, so many things, other things can happen, yes. Yeah.
All right, we have to move on for the next.
Good point. So we didn't get in the details. So a lot of the information which goes into these models come from the constitutive models or capillary pressure saturation, all that. So we actually, in the experiment, we run this experiment with the soils and we get the data. So it's already built into our model, but your point is well taken that all this thing depends on the other information which are missing in this type of.